We're on the battlefield for right. Jesus. Come and join us in the fight.
All out and ready. And tonight we will call on Journey. Have we called on you yet? Nope. You ready? Don't have it? All right. You're on the radar till you have it. All right. Have I called on you yet? Long time ago. Who hasn't been called on yet? Alex, you haven't been called on? Okay, so Journey's on the radar. Alex is on tonight. Let's start with the verse. Nope.
Hello.
All right, here we go. All right, Psalms 27, 14. Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Psalms 27, 14.
It's good. What is the main teaching of this verse in your own words? What is the main teaching of this verse in your own words?
All right. In my own words, wait on the Lord. That God is our source of sustainment in this life. And when we spend time with him regularly, we can be strengthened and encouraged.
Amen. I have strength comes from those that continuously wait on the Lord and look to him. What are other verses that help me to understand this verse?
Isaiah 40, 31, Psalm 31, 24, Psalm 41, Proverbs 20, 22.
Good. I hope everybody got Isaiah 40, 31. We already got that one. What are some things this verse teaches me about God? Alex?
God wants to be our strength. He wants fellowship and communion with us.
Amen. What sins do this verse reprove?
Idolatry, pride of life.
Amen. And what are some things this verse teaches me about myself and my daily life?
It is important in my life that I seek God for my life, that I may have strength spiritually in my life by being continually in God's presence and word.
All right, and then one other thing, and we'll have our hymn. What are other lessons from this verse?
I guess reading it, the biggest thing to me was we have the promise. You know, when the verse says, and he shall, you know, we have the promise that God will strengthen you when you wait on him for whatever he calls you to in this life.
Right. He said his verse. It was a little slow, but he said every word right. Time stands still when Alex is on the, when Alex has the mic, whether it's to pray or to speak, it's like time stands still, man. But time just stands still. But he got every word. He wasn't caught unprepared. He wasn't caught unprepared. He said every word. He had something for the main teaching. It was spot on. He had cross references. He gave us the lessons that he learned. And then finally, did you say that verse to a partner?
Yes.
Amen. Let's have some singing.
Let's turn to our hymnals tonight. 834, the Uncloded Day. 834. The Uncloded. Please stand with me as we sing this familiar hymn, The Uncloded Day. Storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of hope when the storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Oh, they tell me of a home where my friends have gone. Oh, they tell me of that land far away. Oh, and a tree of life in eternal bloom sheds its fragrance through the unclouded day. Oh, the land of cloudless day. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Oh, they tell me of a king in his beauty there. And they tell me that mine eyes shall behold where he sits on the throne that is whiter than snow, in the city that is made of gold. Oh, the land of cloudless day. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a hope when no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Oh, they tell me that he smiles on his children there, and his smile drives their sorrows away. And they tell me that no tears ever come again in that lovely land of unclouded day. Oh, the land of cloudless day. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day.
Let's remain standing for prayer.
Heavenly Father, we thank you that we have been invited to come into your presence, that you told us to come boldly unto your throne of grace to obtain mercy and help in time of need. Lord, this is a time of need. There are needs all over this auditorium, dire needs, real needs. And Father, we have no real recourse but your throne. Lord, we come humbly tonight, but we come boldly to ask you to help us as individual believers on this pilgrimage journey. I pray that you'd put a fire in our hearts to want victory that comes through Christ. We thank you for that victory that comes through the Lord Jesus Christ. And I pray that we would claim it and that we would walk in victory. Lord, we thank you that the blood has been shed. We thank you that because of that precious blood, we have access to your throne to come as children of yours. And we cry tonight, Abba, Father. Deep spiritual needs, hurts, confusion, depression, sorrow, loneliness. Lord, these are not things that we are equipped to carry ourselves. Hurts. Oh Lord, I pray for your help tonight in this service. I pray that we would be a congregation taking your word serious tonight. And I pray that you would speak to our hearts. We thank you for those who prayed to be saved today.
Amen.
We praise your name for that. We ask that you help us to continue to serve you with zeal. Pray for your hand of blessing on the church. Lord, we're nothing. I pray that we would have a humility that would say, we're nothing. Grow us, Lord. Help us to see things more clearly because your word was open tonight. Put a hedge of protection about our homes, especially in this area of music. And God, I pray that you would revive us again. In Jesus' name, amen.
You may be seated. Let's continue singing tonight.
252 will be our next hymn. 252, Spirit of the Living God, form fresh on me. 252. Let's wind that one back a little bit. Wrong song that I thought we were singing. This is not Spirit of the Living God. So let's go ahead and have the piano play through this one. Let's see if we can learn a new song tonight. Amen? All right. Switch up. Missionary offering at this time.
right. Next week on Sunday morning for our mortgage burning ceremony, we will be having special music in our service, and of course we will be preaching a gospel message. One of the managers from Centere Bank, which is the largest privately owned bank in Indiana, will be here, and we'll be giving them a big presentation check from Cornerstone Baptist Church. And then once the service is over, we'll take a big group picture. We'll take two pictures. We're going to take one for our guests, with our guests, just our guests, and then one, the Cornerstone congregation. And then we're going to move outside and burn the note on the building, and then come back inside and have cake fellowship, and then just rejoice in what the Lord has done. And so be praying about it. It's a special service. The gospel is going to be preached. I know there'll be unsaved people here, people that you've invited, people that I've invited. Let's get them out to hear that the debt is paid, not just the mortgage debt, but their sin debt is paid. Let's get them out for that. Ushers, if you'll come, if you have a cell phone, make sure it's powered off at this time. And Jericho, if you would lead us in prayer as we take up our offering.
Let's pray. Father, Lord, once again, thankful, God, for a good day in your house, and Lord, for the sermon that was preached this morning of our nation. We pray, Father, for the return of our nation to you, Lord, and that's going to start in the homes of our churches, Father, in our own hearts. I pray, Father, Lord, that we just continue to seek you, Father, this year. And Lord, I pray, God, that we'd have a year like none other. Pray, God, you bless this offering. Bless our service, Lord. Thank you. In Christ's name, amen.
All right, let's sing our last song, 843, I'd Rather Have Jesus. Please stand with me. 843, I'd Rather Have Jesus Than Silver or Gold, 843. I'd rather us than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than men's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be the king of a alas, he's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from out the comb. He's all that my hungering spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus than to be of a vast domain or be hell in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
May be seated, but before our choir comes, I was told that there's a special young man that made birthday yesterday, so I don't want to forget little Milky Don Anderson. Not you, Steve. You already made birthday. Nah, you good. All right. Milky Don, this one is for you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
And to celebrate his fifth birthday, the Andersons are going to be having cupcakes for little Milky after church. So join us in the gym. Yes, Julian, more cake. Yep. It's Sunday night at Cornerstone. Cake, right? Amen. All right. Choir, you can come.
Oh, if you weren't here this morning, I could have easily added what we're going to speak about tonight to this morning's message as one of the sins of our nation. That was the title of the message. It's on Facebook, our Facebook page. It's on YouTube. It's there. But if you did not get a chance to hear that message for whatever reason, I would encourage you to do so. I could have easily listed music, the wrong type of music, when we talked about those different sins of our nation. And tonight we're going to do that, and we're starting with a continuation of the devil's attack on sacred music and how he uses culture to mix together with the music to bring something into the church that was never supposed to be there. And because people are so attached to culture, they'll hang on to the culture when it's good, which isn't wrong. Culture is not wrong. Culture just means way of life, the way we live. But the problem is when we hang on to culture when it's bad. When it's bad. And we hang on to culture when it's bad and we let that into the church, we weaken the church. We weaken the church. And we can't have a strong church if we break down those walls of separation. That is exactly what Israel did when they broke down those walls of separation between clean and unclean, the holy and the unholy. God judged them because they didn't keep the wall up, okay? And so a wall of separation, not being afraid to say that is clean and not being afraid to say that is unclean. And when it comes to music, music is not neutral. We established that in our last lesson on this topic. Music is not neutral. And so music is one of those things that you can point to and say, that is clean. That is unclean. And if we let unclean music into our homes, if we let unclean music into our ears, into our cars, if we mess around with unclean music, it's going to affect our life in a negative way. And so the devil knows that. What better way then to get the church than to aim those guns at the music in the church? Take the music in the church and turn it worldly, thereby weaken that church. It is the devil's attack. There's no doubt about it. But this picture is depicting God judging Israel. You can read this account in the Bible. Because they played around with sin. And God is still a holy God who judges sin. The Bible says in Ezekiel 22:26, her priests have violated my law and have profaned mine holy things. They have put no difference between the holy and profane. Neither have they showed difference between the unclean and the clean. And have hid their eyes from my Sabbaths, and I am profaned among them. Let's look there. I want you to look there in your Bible. To Ezekiel 22. Just so you know that this is the Bible, this isn't something that we're making up. It's talking about corrupt priests, the law being despised, and no difference between the unclean and the clean. That ought not to be your home. That ought not to be your home. That there's no difference between the clean and that there is a mixing of the clean and unclean, that wall is torn down. It ought to be very clear in your home that these things are clean and these things are unclean. But these priests were corrupt. They did not believe in separation. They liked religion, but not separation. Not separation. And so 22, 26, her priests have violated my law. Don't lose that. And so when we talk about music, we talk about the modern contemporary Christian music, and does that honor the Lord? Does the contemporary stuff honor the Lord? Modern or madness, contemporary Christian music, is it honoring to God? And I think that this modern and madness description is a good description of traditional gospel music. What's called the black gospel, the contemporary gospel, I argue is nothing more than the world sound mixed with some good words and then sold to the church. This thinking says that all music is holy and nothing is profane. It's just music. And after all, it's talking about God. What could be wrong with it? It's like saying all dress styles are okay. It's just the way I like to dress. It doesn't matter if stuff's flying out and stuff's hanging short and things are tight and alluring in a sinful way. It's the way I like to dress. It's putting no difference between the holy and the unholy. It's the old mindset that God accepts anything. He accepts anything. Ignoring the fact that there are some things that God says are right and things that he says are wrong. And so the worldliness in black gospel music is seen in that it borrows from the world's sensual rhythms. And a lot of people don't care. They don't care. I'm sure there's people here tonight that would say, that's why I like that type of music. Because it borrows from the world's sensual rhythms. I want to say that's why your life is messed up. Because you want to borrow from the world and say you love God too, and the two cannot mix. And so we should not have music brought into our church that's designed to make you want to get up and dance down the aisles. You see, the club and church shouldn't mix. And the black gospel music borrows from the world's sensual rhythms. Black gospel proudly uses the R&B style, the hip-hop style, the style that we were saved out of, that style that talked about having sex with people that you're not married to and doing drugs and hating the police and shooting dope and selling marijuana, that music. Black gospel says, let's borrow from that sound. And I want to say, no, sir. Amen. That's what I want to say. And that music is openly used. If you were ever in the world and you went to any of those wicked concerts, that music is openly used to celebrate the flesh and the works of the devil. And so it's worldly music when it sounds like the music that the world uses for their sinful activities. What are their sinful activities? Okay, if it sounds like it belongs in a club, it shouldn't be in God's house. It's really simple. If it sounds like it belongs in a bar, it shouldn't be in God's house. Okay, and it shouldn't be in your house. If it sounds like it belongs at any of these places, it shouldn't be in the church and your house. Okay? We don't bring that into the church. You shouldn't bring it into your car either. For a lot of reasons. A lot of reasons. You say, I like it. Your life's messed up. Guarantee it. If you compare it to what the Bible says a life can be. Jesus said, I came to give you life and life more abundantly. And so we don't bring this into the church. We're just not gonna. And nothing that's played in this church while I'm the pastor is going to sound like this. It's not going to sound like this. You say, I like that music in my car. Your life's messed up. And you know I'm right. I'm right. We're not going to bring this into the church. Nope. Keep it sounding godly. And keep it sounding not separated unto the world, but separated unto God. Keep it holy. Keep it sacred. Keep it something that is good and pure and without any of the taint of the world. No, we're not going to bring this into the church. Not this church. Nope. No, sir. But yet that's what's brought into the church. We could walk to a church from right here that uses this in their Sunday morning worship to reach the young people. We've been reaching young people effectively for 15 years with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Just the gospel. Not this. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And God draws whom he will. And they respond to Jesus, not to this. And so we don't use the world to reach out, okay? We're not trying to see if we can become like them to reach them. We're trying to show them there's a difference in order to reach them, that there's a difference. And so no. You're not going to come in on Sunday morning and see JC up there doing this. It's not possible, right? It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. No. And just the sound of that music would change the whole ministry here to bring that in. It would change everything. And so modern dance music is intimately associated with immorality. I dare you to come up to me after the church service and prove me wrong on this. Modern music, the dance music, is intertwined with immorality, drunkenness, drug abuse, gambling, prostitution. Come on now. What's going on those music videos? Evil. Evil. That's what it is. Evil. And so in your home, make the devil's music hard to get to. Possible for your kids to get to. Some checks and balances so that they're not able to do what their flesh tells them to do in the curiosity of their youth. Make it real, real hard. And unless they have the maturity of a 30-year-old on fire for God, they don't need a cell phone. They don't need a cell phone. Your teenagers are not using that cell phone for godliness. There's not a teenager on earth that should have a cell phone. Most adults shouldn't have a cell phone. Smartphone is what I'm talking about. Why? The old man has cravings. The Bible says to put off the old man and put on the new man, and all of the world's music is instantly accessible with that smartphone. And if you think they're not messing around, you give your teenager a smartphone, and that's not wise. What would you be doing with the smartphone when you were 12? I rest my case. And so we fight this thing. We fight these avenues that the devil would bring. You better be fighting it. If you want your children to turn out for God, you better be fighting all these avenues that the devil wants to bring this into your home. I believe the smartphone is a powerful tool if you use it for God's glory. But the dangers are always there. And it does us no good to pretend like they're not there and to just give our kid a smartphone. The dangers. And so you cannot disconnect the music from those activities. Now, I believe that in my heart. I believe that in my heart of hearts. I know it to be true. I know it to be true. You say, what are you saying? If we had, I'm going to go back a little bit. If we had this music in our church with godly words, okay, the sound of this words, if we had this in our church on the regular or at all, if we let that go, it would change the morality of the people that are members of this church. You follow what I'm saying? Now, if you're not a member, I'm not referring directly to you. If you're not a member, you're an attender. You're basically a visitor of ours if you're not a member. Okay? Now, there's about 45, getting close to 50 of us that are members of this church. And what I'm saying is if we pattern our music after that, I know it. It wouldn't be long before there'd be adultery in the church. Not amongst the not amongst the visitors. I'm talking the members. Adultery, all kinds of wickedness, drunkenness. Why? Because we let it in through the music. You can't disconnect the music from these activities. So if you bring any of these styles into your home, into your car, what else are you bringing with it? You bring that into your home, what are you bringing with it? Marijuana? You bring that into your home, what are you bringing with it? Booze? You bring that into your home, what are you bringing with it? Pornography? Come on now, it's the truth. And I hope you understand it. And so, going back, sex, drugs, and rock and roll is a true slogan. So why would a Christian want to use those kind of elements? Why would we want to incorporate that into the sound of our music? We shouldn't. So we're talking about styles of music that preach a wrong message. And one of the things is the heavy backbeat. Of course, there's the syncopated dance styles. There's the sensual vocal styles, the breathy sensual style, the soft style, the unresolving chord styles. When you're picking out Christian music to listen to play in your home, make sure that they're not employing these things if you don't want to let those other things into your home right with it. Be very careful that your music doesn't preach a wrong message. I'm not even talking about the words. I keep saying that because I hope you're getting it. I'm not even talking about the words. I'm talking about the way it sounds. And so that heavy backbeat, do, 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 do. Yeah, you smile, it's really not funny. It's going to destroy your life. It's going to destroy your life. That backbeat is going to be one of the things that's going to bring you down. The devil uses music. Elvis Presley, his name's been in the news a lot lately because of his daughter. But Elvis Presley said this, it's the beat that gets to you. If you like it and you feel it, you can't help but move to it. That's what happens to me. I can't help it. And so he is controlled, admitting, like Michael Jackson did, like they all do, admitting that he's controlled not by the Spirit of God, not by the Word of God, but controlled by the rhythm and beat of the music. So why would a believer want to use that in the church? Why would a believer want to have that in their home? Why would a believer want to do that? They shouldn't. How about Luke Campbell from Two Live Crew? He said the sex is definitely in the music, and sex is in all aspects of the music. That's their own admission. This isn't a Baptist preacher saying that. That's them saying that. Hello! The sensual and sexy backbeat has been the chief characteristic of the worldly dance music since the beginning of the 20th century. They don't hide it. They're not trying to hide it. No, that's what sells. Man, that's what fills the concerts. They're not trying to hide it. So why do we want that same beat in the church? And so we these things will affect our lives, not just what we hear, but our lives. Okay, you're not the type of Christian that you dress like on Sunday. Okay, you're the type of Christian that you dress like tomorrow. You hear me? And if you're going to wear tight clothing, you might as well wear nothing at all and save a lot of money. Because you're revealing the same thing. You see? Most independent Baptist churches don't preach on modesty. But Paul did. And he told Timothy to do the same thing. And so we need to be careful that we don't adopt the mindset of the world, the worldliness. Okay, she's hot. What are we saying? That you're lusting after her in a sexual manner. Why would you use that terminology? Okay. The music affects a lot of this. God's not going to accept our Sunday morning worship, our morning service, our evening service, our midweek service, when we use the same style of music as the wicked heathen do. I don't believe he accepts that. I'll tell you why, he's a jealous God. So why would a believer want to borrow from that? That's very clearly what's been done. Why would, and again, people don't even realize it, but they come and visit our church and they wonder, why doesn't their music sound like? And if they were honest and had thought it through, they would be saying, why hasn't that church borrowed from the world for their music? And I say that is by design, because we want his blessing upon this church. We want his blessing. And so we have to talk about these things, like syncopation in pop music. It started there before it ever got into the church. Rick Snowman was very clear that all dance music makes use of syncopation. What is syncopation? It's a disturbance in the regular flow of the rhythm. So the song is going along, and then there's a disturbance, and it doesn't sound like it belongs, but it is appealing to the flesh. Makes our flesh want to supply the missing beat with a dance move. It's a disturbance in the regular rhythm. It is the shifting the accent to a weak beat or to an off beat. Syncopation. We know it's in pop music, and they make no apology for using it for their purposes. An interruption or disturbance of the regular flow of rhythm, a placement of rhythmic stresses or accents where they would not normally occur. It wouldn't normally be there, but let's put it there because, man, it makes us want to move. That's they're masters at it. And they use machines to do it. Those guys don't know how to play instruments. They use a computer to synthesize, okay, and syncopate and make that sound that you hear. And that's what makes it danceable. Okay, the danceability is due to the syncopation. And so the listener is invited to supply the missing beats through physical gestures. Dance. I don't believe that syncopation in and of itself is wrong. Okay, we hear some syncopation in the Negro spirituals. We hear it, believe it or not, in our own church, but it's so slight. It's so, it livens the music, but it's not enough to make you want to start dancing. There's a balance there. There's nothing wrong with it being used sparingly, but all dance music overuses syncopation, and it's obviously fleshly, it's obviously worldly, and they say so, not me. Okay, I'm preaching their message. Okay, this is what they're saying about their stuff. And so the thing that makes a person dance is the syncopation. The way that music is going along and then it shifts from its normal rhythm. The syncopation can be used sparingly, but when you misuse it, it is worldly. Good syncopation, if we could call it that, when it's used sparingly and appropriately, good syncopation always resolves back to the normal rhythm. In other words, the music doesn't go haywire and jerky and make you want to get up and do the world's dance. Syncopation in moderation can enliven music and make it more interesting. Proper use of syncopation doesn't make you want to do worldly dance moves. That's a good test. You listen to music. If it makes you want to do worldly dance moves, it's of the devil. It's wrong. Shouldn't be in your house. Shouldn't be in your car. Shouldn't be in, it should, and it certainly shouldn't be in God's house. But we brought it to God's house. Not this house, praise the Lord, but we brought it. But there's a proper way to use syncopation. Consider this video of joy to the Lord. It adds some syncopation to liven the music, but it doesn't make you want to do the world's dance. There was some shifting from the normal rhythm, from the normal beat. There was some shifting, but it always resolved back to that familiar tune that we know of, Joy to the Lord. And there was nothing in that that made me want to get up and do the boogie woogie. Okay? And so what should govern your music? Does it make me want to do what the world's music does to them? Does it make me want to do what they do when they hear music? Syncopation can add liveliness to music without making it sensual dance music. Of course, our sermon of the year, Brother McCoy, who is on the Lord's side? Amen. Amen. What a message. And when I came to the Lord, I didn't hear any of his, none of it. You say, why? Because I was in the world. And it was so heavy with what I was listening to, even in church. Because I grew up in the Get Happy Church, the Pentecostal church, okay? And it was so overly used there and so overly used in my own personal life that when I heard Brother McCoy sing, and started listening to his music, singing unto God, I never even know, to me it seemed like there was no syncopation there because of where I was at. But he uses some to liven the music without it becoming worldly.
There are some things that I may not know. Some places I can't go, but I am sure of this one thing, that God is real, for I can feel him deep within, and my God is real, real in my soul, my God is real.
Brother McCoy has about 5 different CDs, and I would suggest you get them and have some godly Christian music from a man of God in the past. He's with the Lord now. Drunk driver killed him and preached better than he could sing, and you'll know that when you listen to one of his sermons. But the proper use of syncopation, Hallelujah Chorus uses a lot of syncopation, but it always gets back to the familiar tune.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
So the syncopation is used in moderation. It doesn't make you want to get up and do what they're doing in the club. Okay? And so it's more of a marching, consistent, start and resolving sound rather than something that is just doing its own thing just to make you do what it wants you to do. And so good music is cheerful. It has the sound of victory. It has, in my opinion, it ought to have a militant fighting sound. It ought to make us want to get up and go serve the Lord and attack the forces of the devil with the word of God. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, and we are in a battle. And so our music should be battle music, not the world's music. And so you can take the hymns and you can redo them. And you can fill the hymns with all types of syncopation and worldly sound, and it'll be these same words. These same words, but it won't sound like we sing it here. Okay? Why? Because it's been filled so much with the world that it meets more of their criteria than God's. Syncopation is huge. Sorry. Here we go. Listen to this. What song is that? Stand up. So you recognize that song. But you see what they did with it? They took Stand Up for Jesus, and took it right to the club. We're not going to do that here.
Amen.
Not going to do that. And so you understood it. You recognized it. You'll go into those churches and you'll like, man, I know that hymn, but we sure don't sing it like that at Cornerstone. Okay, exactly. And it isn't addictive. The flesh likes it. That's the problem. You say, but I like it. That's the problem. Your flesh starts to like it. And our flesh is evil. Paul said, for in me dwelleth no good thing. He knew his flesh was evil. And so what will happen is you'll get hooked on this, and you'll spoil your taste for godly music. And so we must be careful with syncopation. Syncopation in pop music is a fundamental constant presence. Duke Ellington said, it don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing. They know it, and they're very open about it. Unrelenting syncopation has been a chief characteristic of worldly dance music since the beginning of the 20th century. Syncopation, again, overly added to these music. What's the word? Genres?
Genre,
did I say it right? Ragtime, boogie-woogie, blues, jazz, big band swing, honky-tonk, western swing. Ragtime got its name from the raggedy, jerky rhythm, okay? Now, this isn't church, this isn't gospel music. It's just a form of music that became known as ragtime. But it was brought right into the church, and I'm going to show you that before we're done tonight. Brought right into the church. So we're going way back to 1902. This guy got a hold of ragtime and said, let me put that to a gospel song, Lily of the Valley. Let me see if I can combine that. Let me combine that. Mr. Barker to shame. Boogie Woogie is ragtime on steroids, we could call it. This isn't Christian. This is gospel. This is Boogie Woogie. So the gospel artists, the earlier gospel artists said, we can take boogie woogie, just like we took ragtime.
Called sweeter as the days go by.
The more I touch him, the more I love him, and nothing good for me to deny. Well, the longer I know him, the better life to show him. I couldn't stop.
Black Gospel said we can do that too. Into the church meeting. Some common types of syncopated dance rhythm: the backbeat, the silent beat, the break beat, the beat anticipation ending a phrase. And here's a quote from Bill Haley: I felt that if I could take a tune and drop the first and third beats and accentuate the second and fourth and add a beat the listeners could clap to as well as dance, this would be what they were after. Do you understand that they're trying to craft the thing according to our lusts? Okay, and present something that sells, that lines their pockets. I dig that rock and roll music. It has a backbeat. You can't lose it. They knew that the essential element to rock music was the backbeat. You cannot lose it. That's the music of today. You can't lose it. Okay? And so what people are looking for when they visit our church and they hear the special music, they're listening for that. It's foreign because it's not there. It's not there. And it's not there because the rock and rollers say, it's got to be there. Rock and roll is sex. And if we're going to sell this, it has to have a backbeat. You can't lose it. Syncopation and the backbeat. The backbeat is in contrast to a straight or march rhythm. A march has the strong emphasis on the first beat. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Or the first and third beat. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. The emphasis is where it ought to be, just like in a march. Straight beat. It's decent. It's orderly. It resolves. It marches. It's not dead, but it's consistent. It doesn't sound like a club. So what happens when you bring the backbeat into the church? All of those were illustrations of a consistent march beat following a rhythm. But when you play with the backbeat, you get this.
Ho! Brothers and sisters, I want to welcome you back to life. Back to the one that can make your next chapter.
And that's what the devil's doing in the churches. But not this church.
Amen.
And hopefully not your home.
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you would use these things in all of our hearts and help us to be more careful. Lord, all of us, even ones that are doing a decent job, a good job, all of us could be more careful. Help us, I pray, to have your wisdom. I pray some good decisions would be made tonight. In Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand to your feet with your heads bowed.